Here's why you should never land like a superhero. Superheroes love to make an entrance. And if they are flying or falling, that entrance is frequently them crashing down knee and fist first in a stance that is undeniably cool, especially in slow motion. But unless you are a super-powered individual, you should never break out a landing like this because it's almost perfectly designed from a scientific standpoint to break you. The superhero or three-point landing is where you land in a half crouch, with one knee and sometimes a fist or two impacting the ground directly. It surely looks cinematic, but as I claim, like Deadpool claims, it is really, really hard on your knees and it is totally impractical. But why would the superhero landing be impractical or dangerous? How is it any different from landing on your feet? What is going to make any landing that you attempt harder or softer is going to come down to impact force. And if you are falling on this planet, that force is going to be applied to you by the surface of the Earth, or whatever comes in between you and the surface of the Earth when you are falling. Physics nerds like me like to say that it's not the fall that kills you. It's the m delta v over delta t. Does not have the same ring to it. But this equation describes how quickly something's momentum changes. Momentum is mass times velocity. So, right before impact, the more something's momentum is about to change, go from some velocity to zero, or the more quickly all that momentum comes to a complete or partial stop, the more force it is going to take. That is why something like an ant with a tiny, tiny mass and therefore momentum can hit the ground after falling off of a cliff and be fine, but Deadpool cannot. Ew. It's on my hand. You cannot change your mass and you can't change Earth's gravity. So the easiest thing for you to do to reduce the forces on you when landing is to extend the amount of time it takes for your momentum to come to a complete stop. And to demonstrate this, consider the simple egg. It's a wonderful little evolutionary creation that is famous for both its strength and its fragility. Now, if I threw this egg up and let it hit the hard ground that I'm standing on, it would break. But if I extend the amount of time the egg comes to a stop in by catching it with something soft like this sheet, the egg is fine, as you can see. Timing is incredibly important in this calculus. When the timing is extended, then the egg is fine. But if the time is shortened, then, oh, they get it. Oh. Oh! Oh! Oh, it hurts! Oh, is it dripping? How much is it dripping? Ow. Did you get it? How does all this apply to the superhero landing? Well, let me show you by getting out of here. Coming in hot! Here I am at my local rock climbing gym. Because time to stop is so important for impact force, let's time how long it takes me to attempt a normal landing and a superhero landing, respectively. My SHL attempts averaged about a third of a second. Wow, so cinematic. And here are my normal landing attempts. These averaged a little over half a second. As you can see, the SHL stopped me quite a bit more quickly, and trust me, you can feel that force difference. For superheroes that fall from great heights and therefore land at great velocities, this time difference is even more important. Mr. Star! It's me! So now let's estimate the kinds of forces that a real superhero like Iron Man would undergo during a superhero landing. How about when Iron Man slams down on that stage during Iron Man 2? I know, but I like Sam Rockwell. For the sake of simplicity, I'm going to assume that Iron Man first stabilizes himself and then turns off his repulsors to free fall from a distance of 30 meters above the stage, about 100 feet. And I'm going to assume no air resistance because it is easier that way. Now, knowing the fall distance and the acceleration due to gravity, we can use these kinematic equations, or equations of motion, to first find how long it takes Tony to free fall to the ground during the superhero landing, and then his velocity right before impact. Plug all of that into our It's Not the Fall That Kills You equation, along with Tony Stark's mass, his final velocity from this kinematic equation, and the time it takes for Tony Stark to come to a stop, which looks like just a single frame of the movie in Iron Man 2, and you get a total force when Tony Stark comes slamming down onto that stage of 112,000 newtons, the equivalent of a head-on car collision at highway speeds. No, Mr. Stark, wait, comfort me, I don't feel good. Treat me like a spider boy. Speaking of car crashes, how about another example? Like when Batman crashes down on the hood of a van during a superhero landing in The Dark Knight. Using the same equations but changing some values around, I'm assuming that Batman weighs 95 kilograms, that he's falling from a distance of around 6 meters, about 2 stories, and he comes to a stop within 4 movie frames, and you find that in that scene, when Bruce's knee comes smashing down on the top of that van, he is enduring over 6,000 newtons. Now, for context, estimates for what it takes to shatter the strongest bone in your body, the femur, come in at 4,000 newtons. That means that without some super suit or something else to protect you, these kinds of superhero landings, at least in these examples, would totally break you. I do not want to be here when that starts to grow back. The only thing that you can really control in these force equations is the stoppage time. And that's exactly why, during a normal landing, we bend our legs. It extends the amount of time our momentum has to come to a complete stop, and thereby it lowers the forces on our bodies. And trust me, you want to do that, you feel the difference. But do not take my word for it. For the sake of completeness, and to prove just how much of a difference a simple difference in timing can make, I ramped it up. Oh. Okay, so here I am about to attempt a normal landing from the exact same height that Batman landed in The Dark Knight, the scene that we just went through. There's a lot of padding under me and our positions aren't exact, but it's close enough for our purposes, and I didn't want to hurt myself. Clocking my stoppage time here, it takes me just about 0.275 seconds to come to a complete stop. If you extend Batman's stopping time in that Dark Knight scene to my stopping time doing a normal landing from the same height, you get a reduction in force of a full 39%. Now, I know that Batman was trying to crush that bad guy's van, but what I am trying to prove is that the difference between a normal landing and a superhero landing, even though the times are just fractions of a second, can be the difference between maybe walking away from a landing and definitely not. Because this percentage reduction takes the force that's on Bruce Wayne well out of the femur shattering bone zone. It's better. Because there is little to no leg bending, the superhero landing is almost designed to break you. But if you could withstand these forces, it would make for a pretty good entrance, right, Batman? That is annoying. Looking back at those SHL forces we calculated, those forces are gonna be acting over some surface area. Let's just assume that's mostly the surface area of a knee. Now, I measured the surface area of my knee, and it came to around 39 square centimeters. Now, if Tony Stark came flying in and did a superhero landing with the mass and velocity that we assumed earlier, then the pressure at his knee upon impact would be nearly 30 million pascals. The compressive strength of concrete ranges from around 17 to 28 megapascals, which means that if a hero like Stark came screaming in for a superhero landing with forces at his knee, like we are assuming, then just like in the movies, at point of impact, the concrete would crack. And it would crack other similarly strong materials. At least if those heroes had the same mass and velocity of Mr. Stark. Wait, don't go, I still don't feel good. Oh boy. But even though the required pressures are there, to make a superhero landing really look right, you would need another particular power, super density. Smart boy Isaac Newton came up with a very clever approximation for how far one object would penetrate into another if everything was moving at sufficiently high velocity. He found that the depth of penetration will depend on the length of the object and the ratio of the densities of the impactor and the impacted. For example, a bullet versus jello will have a very high ratio, meaning the penetration will be high. But for something like wood versus the density of steel, the penetration is very low because the ratio is low. Now, this approximation really only applies to really fast moving objects like bullets and meteors, but it gets us where we want to go. A normal human knee made out of skin and bone is much less dense than concrete, which means that without some power like superhuman density, a human knee during a superhero landing is more likely to smoosh than smash. Some superheroes might still be able to pull off this grand entrance, though. Remember in the first Iron Man film when Tony Stark says that his suit is made out of a gold titanium alloy? Well, gold is the seventh most dense element on Earth. It's even denser than uranium, and uranium is highly valued in weaponry for its penetrating power because of its density. So if Iron Man had an ultra-dense suit, or if another superhero had an ultra-dense property to their body because of some other superpower, then there's actually a good chance that they could come in for a ground-shattering superhero landing without smooshing themselves. Come on, man! I'm already like Bucky, but you, with your squishy human body, should never land like a superhero. If you're falling from a height of a meter, it's fine, trust me, I tried, but any higher than that, and the three-point landing is impractical on almost every level. Deadpool was right. Even if you could withstand the high forces that the superhero landing imposes on you by minimizing the amount of time your momentum has to come to a stop, you still need another superpower like super density to make sure that you do not smooge during the process. The three-point landing is already a term in aviation. It describes when an airplane lands with all three wheels at once instead of two and then the nose. It's considered bad because the nose landing gear isn't designed to take those kinds of forces, and neither are your knees. I know it doesn't look as cool, but your patellas will pathank you. Because science, time to jump on out of here. Oh, my quads. Can't do it. It was for science. I mean, yes, if you're falling 100 feet, you're gonna get messed up regardless, but what I'm saying is that you will be messed up less if you land normally because it extends the amount of time. That's the same thing that parkour guys do. They land and roll and they're falling further than they otherwise would, and that increases the amount of time and lowers the force. That's how they can drop from so far. And I'm limping around the void today. My quads are killing me because of this. Morpheus knew that. That's why he always landed and tried to hurt someone with his knee powers. Thank you so much for watching, Robert. If you like this video and you are on the Because Science channel, please consider liking on the Facebook page and subscribing and hitting that notification bell on the YouTube page. There's a lot of other nerdy stuff that we get up to on this channel, so go find it. If you want more of me, check out Must Watch on Nerdist.com, where me and my colleague Dan Casey talk very sillily about a very serious man, and go to Project Alpha at projectalpha.com, where if you sign up, you can get this show 2 days earlier than anyone else. Look at that. And follow me and Because Science here-ish.